Grace be unto you in peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to read the first lesson again for you, and you may wish to follow along in the back of your bulletin. It's a prophecy from the prophet Isaiah, spoken some 70 plus years before this event took place. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him and to loose the belts of kings, to open doors before him that gates may not be closed. I will go before you and level the exalted places. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and the hoards in secret places, that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who calls you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel my chosen, I call you by your name. I name you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I equip you, though you do not know me, that people may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all these things. It doesn't take us very long after we read the newspaper or watch our television sets to conclude that there's an awful lot of evil in our world, and it seems to be winning the day. Most of us, I'm sure, watched in horror as we witnessed the mass killings in Las Vegas several weeks ago. Our fears are ratcheted up as we read about terrorists going on killing sprees, as we hear about murder and mayhem, about shootings that seem to take place every day in our neighborhood, as we hear the threats and the counter-threats that are being thrown around between North Korea and the United States, and we wonder whether we might be on the path of some nuclear missile in the days ahead. We know that evil is in our world, and we wonder sometimes if it's going to win the day, if evil itself is going to be the victor in the end. Scripture gives us an answer to that. Is it true? And it says with an emphatic and resolute term, no, never. Holy Scriptures remind us that God continues to control history, not in some deterministic way as if each and every one of us were a puppet on a string, but in using everything that takes place in history, the good things and the bad things, in order to steer it towards his end. And that end is to save you. And sometimes he even intervenes in history to make it happen. And that's what we see in this Old Testament lesson for today. How God intercedes in the course of history so that his ultimate will is going to be done. And it's recorded, as I mentioned before, in the prophecy of Isaiah, our Old Testament lesson. It is spoken some 70 to 100 years before the one who is identified here comes into existence. It's here that we read about the rise of Cyrus of the Persian Empire. And through that prophecy, this morning we are reminded that all that evil can muster against our God is not going to hinder him from accomplishing his purposes. That he can and he will even use people who don't know him or believe in him in order to accomplish his will. Even evil is going to bow down before the mighty eternal God. Let's take a good close look at this text. Isaiah begins, "Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him, and to loose the belts of kings, to open doors before him, that the gates may not be closed. Thus says the Lord to his anointed. That God should call Cyrus his anointed one is really surprising. Cyrus is not one of God's chosen people. Cyrus is not a king of Israel. Cyrus is not even a believer. Twice, Isaiah says, "You do not know me," in reference to Cyrus and to God. Cyrus is a pagan. He's a ruler of a foreign empire. And he's going to come, and he's going to conquer nations, including God's own people. And God calls him his anointed. He says to him, "I call you by name. I name you my anointed." And as I said at the beginning of our service, that's the name that is normally used only to refer to Jesus, to the anointed one, to this Messiah, to the Christ. And so we have to ask the question, what has God got to do with Cyrus? Well, we find out as we continue with this text. "I will go before you and level the exalted places. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and the hoards in secret places, that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name." God is going to use Cyrus to subdue the nations. He's going to use him to conquer foreign powers, even the most powerful nation at that time, the Babylonians. It would be as if the gates of their cities would just fly open as Cyrus and his army would approach. They would plunder them then. They would take everything of value. And that's exactly what happened when Cyrus came on the scene. History actually records that the Persian Empire conquered lands with unprecedented speed and ease, that even Babylon, that strong nation of the day, the most powerful one, fell almost without a fight. And why would God let this happen? Well, the text continues. It says, "For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen." God is guiding history. Here he is intervening in the course of history for the sake of his people. But how has the Persian Empire conquering Israel, the lands, going to benefit Israel? Well, we need to know where Israel has been for the last 70 years. And those of you who know your Old Testament history know that Israel was in exile. For 70 years, they were in exile in Babylon. 70 years earlier, God had permitted the Babylonians to conquer his people because of their rebellion against him. But through Cyrus now, Babylon, their captors, were going to be destroyed. And history tells us, amongst Cyrus's earliest decrees after his victory was to permit the Jews to go back home. God uses Cyrus, one who doesn't know him, to return his chosen people to their promised land. "For the sake of my servant Joseph and Israel, my chosen one." This is just one of a multitude of examples that we find in Holy Scripture where we see God moving and directing the course of history. God's not sleeping. God is not too weak to act. He is in control of history. And the promise that God made to you and was placed upon you in your baptism is still sure. You belong to him. And he is still governing everything for the good of his children. That's you and that's me. so that even the evil that comes into our world will in the end submit to his will. There are all kinds of examples that we could point to in Scripture, but I want to focus on how Judah's return from exile set up history, the history that was to come. That time when God himself was actually going to step into history, to intervene in history, and to guide history. And that is a reference to the arrival of his second anointed one, a chosen king that was going to do the will of his father perfectly. This anointed one to come was not like Cyrus. This one knew the Father in heaven, and he perfectly submitted to his Father's will. But just look at the evil that came upon this anointed one. Satan tempts him in the wilderness. The pious religious folks of his day try to stone him. Judas betrays him. Caiaphas, the head of the church, condemns him and turns him over to Pilate. The crowds, they call for his crucifixion. Roman soldiers mock him and beat him, and they hang him on a cross to die. Just look at what evil does. Just look at how it appears that God must have gone to sleep, or that he's just too weak to intercede, that evil is going to triumph in the end. That is, until you hear Jesus say from that cross with authority, "Father, forgive them." And then that one great word that fells them all, "It is finished." The job has been completed. The work, Father, that you chose me to do is now done. God uses the evil that takes place in the course of history in order to accomplish his will. All done for the sake of his chosen ones. Sin paid for, evil destroyed. There's forgiveness for the world, new life for the world, eternal life for all. Eternal life for all through faith in Jesus Christ. This morning, I want to place into your minds and into your hearts some assurance. I want you to be able to rest assured that in the midst of all the stuff that we see happening in our world, that God is still in control. That he uses people like Cyrus and others to accomplish his purposes. The text continues where the Lord says to Cyrus, "Though you do not know me, I equip you, though you do not know me, that people may know from the rising of the sun and from the west, there is none beside me. I am the Lord, there is no other. I form light and I create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all of these things." In spite of what we hear and read and see that's going on in this world of sin in which we live, I want you to rest in the promise that none of it is going to change what God has in store for you in eternity. That nothing will ever separate you from his love in Jesus Christ. That God is always working for the good of his children, for you and for me, even using those people who don't know him or acknowledge him, in order to accomplish his will and his purpose. That's good news to remember and to live by. Amen. And now may the peace of God that passes all our understanding keep your hearts and minds centered in Christ Jesus. Amen.